is described as an act of righteousness. He perfectly obeyed for us because we couldn't. And it's, in some respects, similar with you. Your life is an act. It's a book. It's a package. It's a sum deal. And your whole life is to be lived as an act of worship to God. Living for God, serving Him, is worship. That's why it says at the end of our verse, this is your spiritual worship. Now the Bible does make distinctions between different kinds and aspects and set times of worship. That's true. And let's reflect on a few of those different times and aspects or kinds of worship. First, there was what we might sometimes refer to as our private devotions. Sometimes call it that because Jesus called it that one time. He was saying, when you pray, don't be like the hypocrites. Don't stand on the street corner. Don't sound a trumpet before you when you pray. No, when you pray, go into your room and close the door and pray to your Father who is in secret worship. That's what Isaac was doing when Abraham's servant brought Rebekah. They're nearing the encampment of Isaac. And Rebekah says, "Who's that man standing out there?" And the servant says, "That's my master's son." Isaac, it says, had gone out into the field to meditate. He was having his quiet time. He was doing his devotions, we might say. That's what Daniel did three times a day when he was in exile in a foreign land. He'd open his doors toward Jerusalem and he'd pray. He was having his quiet time. So that's secret worship. It has a crucial place in your everyday life. But then there's family worship. We're all familiar with those words of Joshua. When he told the Israelites as they had initially taken the land, he said, "Choose this day whom you will serve. But as for me and my house, we will serve the Lord." There's family worship and fathers, husbands, heads of households. Maybe you're a single mother. You have an obligation to lead your family in worship. It's important. But then there's public worship. We sometimes call it corporate worship. That's what we're doing now. That's why we come here today. Corporate worship, what the scriptures frequently refer to as a holy convocation. So, dedicated times and seasons of worship are necessary. They're ordained and commanded by God. Scripture dictates that we have time alone with God. Scripture dictates that we worship Him in our homes as families. Scripture certainly dictates that on one day of the week we come together in holy convocation and worship the Lord together as an assembly of His people. But all of that flows out of a life of worship. Whole life worship. And that's what Romans 12:1 is speaking about. All of life is worship. Now, different versions of the Bible, you might be looking at the New American Standard, maybe the NIV. Different versions of the Bible translate the description of our duty in different ways. So for instance, whereas the ESV says, present your bodies a living sacrifice, holy and acceptable to God, which is your spiritual worship. The NIV says, which is your true and proper worship. The KJV and the New King James say, it's your reasonable service. Now, why do we get these such varying translations there of the Greek? Well, the expression is based on two Greek words, from which we get a lot of English words. The first one is the word from which we get the term logical. And so that teaches us that it's apt. This presenting of our bodies is, it's reasonable, it's appropriate. Because it's logical in that sense, it involves the mind, it's worship and service are almost synonyms. In Exodus, God said, "Let my people go that they may serve me." And what he meant was, let them go so they can worship me. They're my people. They're not going to serve you anymore, Pharaoh. Now they're going to serve me. So let them go. And what do we call what we're doing here? Isn't it natural for us as English-speaking Americans to call this our worship service? That's why. And there's a good reason we call it a service. Because we're serving God when we come here to do this. I ministered for 7 years in Germany. And what we call worship service, the Germans call Gottesdienst. Gottes meaning God. Dienst is their word for service. Service of God is what they call it. So all of Scripture teaches that we are to serve God with our whole lives, serve God with our whole beings. As in the words of the hymn we're about to sing, all my days, all my hours, they belong to Him. I owe them to Him. In another hymn that we sing, we ask God, take my moments and my days. Let them flow in ceaseless praise. So the whole Christian life is an act of worship. And Christian faith requires total consecration to God. And God's mercy places every Christian under that solemn obligation. In our workplace, in our homes, when we're with our families, when we're with our friends, in our marriages, or in our singleness, in our recreation and our leisure as well. It's not that God doesn't allow us any recreation or leisure, but when we engage in our leisure activities, when we engage in recreation, we should do it with an eye to Him and for His glory. We're to do all things, in our eating, in our drinking, whatever we do, as it said in 1 Corinthians 10, verse 31, do all for the glory of the Lord Jesus Christ. If you are in Christ, you are a living sacrifice. That's your status. That's your identity in Him. And that it's that gospel mercy that obligates us to be living sacrifices, to dedicate our lives to God, to eat, sleep, drink, and breathe Christ Jesus. Your sacrifices, always remember that. And remember this too. Because Jesus Christ, the Lamb of God, our Passover, was sacrificed for us. He shed His blood. He went to the altar. He died for you, so that you, His people, can now live for Him and be sacrifices in that sense. Because of His mercy, not to earn His mercy, but because of His mercy, present your bodies as living sacrifices. And because of Jesus Christ, your sacrifice is acceptable to the Lord. It's pleasing to Him. So serve Him with joy. Live for Him. Let's pray together. Heavenly Father, we thank You for the gospel. We thank You for the Lord Jesus Christ and what He has done in our behalf. That He laid down His life for us. That He died as a sacrifice, giving us this high privilege and this obligation, this joyful obligation, to present ourselves as living sacrifices. We need the grace of the Holy Spirit in order to do this. And so we ask for it afresh. We pray, guide us through this day and through this week, that we might be light in this dark world, that we might be salt in this decaying civilization, and that this might all be to the glory of our Savior, who gave His life for us, Jesus Christ. We pray in His name. Amen.
Amen.
Our closing hymn, some of you may know, it happens to be the school song of our denomination of college, Covenant College, All for Jesus, number 565. Let's stand and sing together. receive this benediction. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine upon you and be gracious to you.